almost a month, or I think a month to the day. And I've been working, I came back to the UK after working in the Netherlands for 3 years, and joined CORE as a research fellow. So today I'm going to be talking about seasonal climate variability as one of the things that I'm interested in particularly about seasonal climate prediction using empirical methods. So I want this to be very much a kind of a discussion. If anyone has any questions or if something's not clear, just, you know, shout out. You don't have to wait to the end or anything like that. It's very important that I get an idea of what people are interested in, and hopefully that this is accessible to everybody. So first of all, I was appointed as a research fellow in climate variability and hydrological change. And it may not be so clear to everyone what we mean when we talk about climate change versus climate variability. So I just want to, first of all, with the help of this useful figure that I've pinched from the Australian Bureau of Meteorology, clarify what we mean when we're thinking about weather and climate on different scales. So usually with day-to-day weather, we're thinking about phenomena such as hot spells or rainstorms, that sort of thing, that exist on timescales of a few hours to a few days. But climate variability is more driven by large-scale patterns in the climate system, such as the El Niño sudden oscillation, or ENSO, which I'm sure most people are familiar with, or at least have heard of, which operates sort of on interannual timescales, through to things like the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, which operates slightly longer timescales. And then when we're talking about climate change, we're then thinking about things that exist on timescales of several decades or even centuries. So that's things linked to anthropogenic global warming and other external forces. Today, I'm going to be talking about variability on seasonal timescales and in particular seasonal climate forecasting or prediction. And this is basically the attempt to provide useful information about the climate in the coming months. Okay, so information about the likelihood of things like heat waves, droughts, potentially estimates for crop yields, risk of forest fires, that kind of thing. The seasonal forecast is not like the weather forecast. So weather can be considered a sort of snapshot of continually changing atmospheric conditions, whereas the climate is better considered as a statistical summary of weather events in a particular season. But it's possible to make predictions due to components in the climate system that influence atmospheric circulation, and I'll come on to some of these in a second. But first of all, I just want to say a few things about dynamical seasonal prediction. So this is prediction done with numerical models, so climate models. And very much, this is now a regular activity in a number of different centres around the world, where people are producing operational forecasts for use from a variety of end users and stakeholders. So the dynamical, the process-based models that run on supercomputers and require massive computational expense and also man-hours in development, these are the most important tools that we have in producing not just weather forecasts, but also forecasts on seasonal timescales. So there's numerical weather prediction models which are used to solve complex equations and to model the evolution of the climate system. However, as I mentioned, the development of such systems, such forecast systems, is inherently complex, very expensive in a computational sense, and all forecasts are ultimately prone to errors and biases. So with that in mind, if we think about a possible alternative or a supplementary method for producing forecast information using empirical prediction. So by empirical, as the word implies, we're generating predictions based on experience, so using evidence from the observational record. We're asking, what do observations tell us about the workings of the climate system, and what is the maximum value you can extract from real-world data? So in practice, this involves listing statistical relationships to represent the best known physical processes in the climate system. And usually this relationship is between some regional scale anomalies in a target variable and then climate phenomena on slightly larger scales. There's sometimes a bit of confusion about whether we should refer to empirical prediction or statistical prediction, and these terms are sometimes used interchangeably. This is a very useful textbook by Wu Van der Doel, who asks, are we driven by intuition or are we driven by the desire to apply a particular methodology? And in seasonal forecasting, he argues that it's usually the former. So the first step is always to try and understand physical relationships and then to find a model that best represents these relationships. So with this in mind, what is the place for empirical prediction alongside dynamical prediction systems? So as I mentioned already, it's often the opportunity for empirical methods to be a credible alternative to dynamical forecast systems. But perhaps more importantly, these provide the basis or baseline for dynamical models, which is very important in developing dynamical models, understanding where they could be better and what the limits of their predictability are. In making comparisons between the two sort of forecast approaches, this is where some of the problems lie, because we have to consider that different approaches, different development, therefore different output. And this makes systematic comparison between the two quite tricky, which is something I'll come on to a little later. Well, I want to move on now to thinking about the basis of seasonal predictability and some science and some background. As I mentioned, atmospheric circulation exhibits this sustained variability on various timescales. And we refer to the recurring and persistent patterns of pressure and circulation anomalies as within the climate system as teleconnections. And the idea is if we have existing knowledge of a teleconnection, we can develop an empirical model to represent it. So there's a number of different modes of variability in the climate system that offers potential for predictability. The most important of these, as I've already mentioned, is the El Niño Southern Oscillation. This is the periodic variation in wind with sea surface temperatures in the central and eastern equatorial Pacific. So a positive phase event, so which is known as El Niño, is characterized by warmer than average waters in the central and eastern Pacific. And then the negative phase, which is La Niña, is more or less the opposite. And each of these phases is associated with a number of fairly well understood teleconnections in different parts of the world. Many of these occur in developing countries in and around the Pacific area. Certainly in South America along the Pacific coast. Sort of a positive phase, an El Niño phase, is associated with warm and wet conditions, which can lead to things like flooding. One of the best known teleconnections, and something that we saw in the last El Niño event in 2015, is the drought conditions that persist in Southeast Asia. In contrast, during a negative phase, a La Niña phase, conditions are predominantly wet, again leading to things like flooding. So a lot of these regions are at the mercy of the ENSO phase. But there's lots of regions, obviously, where these teleconnections are well understood, sufficiently well understood, that we can use empirical models to represent them. I'll just go through a few more of these because it's quite interesting background, I think. The Pacific Decadal Oscillation is quite similar to ENSO, as you can see from the patterns here, but varies over a much longer time scale. So whereas ENSO, full cycle of ENSO can vary between 3 to 8 years, a particular phase of the PDO may last for 20 to 30 years, so it exists on much longer time scales. The warm phase is characterized by warm waters along the coast of North America, and the cold phase being the opposite. And this is particularly important for climate in North America and in the surrounding region. And it's important to note that when PDO and ENSO are in phase together, that can exacerbate the teleconnections associated with each. Another one that's quite interesting is the quasi-biennial oscillation. This is the regular variation in upper atmospheric winds across the equator. And there's a change in direction of the upper atmospheric winds from westerly to easterly approximately every 13 to 14 months. And amongst the knock-on effects of this, if we have, for instance, an easterly phase, this can really weaken the strength of the Atlantic jet stream, which results in a greater likelihood for colder winters in northern Europe, for example. One more then, in a different part of the world, this is the Indian Ocean Dipole. This is the difference in sea surface temperature between the western and eastern Indian Ocean. A positive episode here is characterized by warmer seas in the west, which consequently is associated with reduced cloud formation and therefore less rainfall in southern Australia, which is obviously already a fairly dry part of the world. So that's just sort of a sample of some of the modes of variability in the climate system that offer sources of predictability. There's also local sources of predictability that we can use, things like terrestrial snow cover, soil moisture content, very important in predicting European temperatures in spring and summer. And then also in coastal regions, taking local sea surface temperatures a month or two in advance is also potentially quite useful. But I'll move on to talking about a little bit about methods now, which was the title of the talk, even though I'm 20 minutes in already. So I'm going to start with the empirical prediction that it's most simplistic, if you like, which is using persistence. And by persistence, we mean observations of a given variable at a particular lead time, which can be taken for a forecast for that variable. So if we're attempting to predict, I don't know, European temperatures during summer, or how much above average they will be, we'd simply look at the spring temperatures and take that anomaly to be the forecast. So very simplistic, but these forecasts frequently perform better than simply taking climatology. So persistence is often used as a reference forecast for other methods. If we have a look at what the best that we can do with persistence is, this is correlation between, this is March, April, May, and December, January, February climate anomalies for the period 1961 to 2013. So the correlation that we see for temperature is reasonably strong, particularly so in the tropics, less so in other regions. And for precipitation, the scale is generally quite limited, but that's sort of the best that we could get if we simply took persistence into account. Stronger skill usually comes from relating the temporal sequence of predictor and predictant events in the observed record by simple linear regression. So we may use a linear regression model, for instance, to describe a relationship between soil moisture content during March, as I mentioned, take it one month before, and then temperature during April, with the idea that dry soil leads to decreased evaporation and increased temperature. But there's plenty of other opportunities for making use of predictive skill in our linear regression model. And one of these is making use of the long-term signal associated with global warming. There's been quite a lot of discussion recently on the merits of using a global warming system as a source of skill in seasonal forecasts. It's something that's been done in decadal forecasting and less so in seasonal forecasting. But again, this is just an example correlation to show the sort of best that we can get if we just take the long-term trend. This is correlation between observed and predicted March, April, May climate anomalies using greenhouse gas concentration as a predictor. So this, again, in large parts of the world, particularly the tropics and in Africa, the correlation is quite high. For precipitation, there's not much skill at all, and that's because precipitation is dominated more so by the internal variability in the climate system. So yeah, useful for temperature, not so much for precipitation. When we're looking to represent tele connections, so that is links between climate anomalies in different parts of the world, non-local regression is more suitable. So, for example, if we were looking to find a linear relationship between European winter temperature and sea surface temperature in some part of the world from a preceding season. And often we're able to use climate indices that describe climate anomalies in different regions. So for ENSO we have the ENIO 3.4 and ENIO 4 indices. PDO and IOD I've talked about already. Moving on then to more complex methods using patterns of variability in spatial fields of climate data. So a very common approach is to use EOF analysis to reduce spatial fields into several modes of variability. That enables us to link a time series of spatial patterns with either a time series at a given location or alternatively another time series of patterns. I'll just attempt to explain this a little better in the figure here. So relating a predictor time series to a predicting time series, this is simple linear regression. If we're attempting to make the link between a time series and a time series of a spatial field, we refer to that as pattern regression, or in this case, one-dimensional pattern regression. I'm going to give a quick example, which is some work that we did forecasting spring rains in Ethiopia using such a method. So just a quick background here in this part of Ethiopia. So we had a century-long precipitation time series in Addis Ababa, which is the capital of Ethiopia. There's generally two distinct rainy seasons. The summer rains are the heaviest ones. The processes involved in the summer rains are reasonably well understood, and there's quite a lot of literature about the predictability of the season. But there's far less attention that was given to the spring rains, which, as you can see, are a lot smaller but are very important for crops that require the full extent of the growing season. So if the spring rains fail, then certain crops don't stand a chance. So the focus was on the spring rains in Addis Ababa. This plot shows correlation between Ethiopia precipitation and sea surface temperatures across the globe. And we noticed this sort of tripod pattern, 1, 2, 3 pole, I guess, that exists in the Pacific Ocean. But rather than take an index relating to ENSO or PDO, or both of them, in a model, we instead chose a region of maximum correlation in the Pacific and generated EOFs on the basis of that spatial grid. And we're able to, with those pattern-based methods, produce correlations in the order of close to 0.5, which is particularly strong for seasonal forecasting. It may not sound like 0.5 would be very good in a weather forecast, but yeah, in seasonal forecasting, that's quite strong. An alternative method would be to have a couple pattern regression. So this is where you're matching pattern of variability in one location with a pattern in another. And there's lots of methods that can be used for such an approach, including canonical correlation analysis, maximum covariance analysis, linear inverse modeling. There's plenty of literature, textbooks and papers out there on the various merits of each. But these methods are generally more appropriate over a limited region where we understand the meteorology quite well to start with. I'll just mention another forecasting method which involves using analogues. I gave a similar talk to this in a training course the year before last, and afterwards I was asked about analogues and I didn't have a slide, so now there's a slide. So if we think that if we're trying to forecast temperature in Europe for the summer months, so June, July, August, we have March, April, May temperature observations, and we also have in our historical record a series of March, April, May temperature observations going back in the historical record for as much data as we have. So the idea in analog forecasting is to identify the climate situation that is the closest match for what we have now. So looking through that climate record, there's various ways of doing this, which I won't go into now. But when you found that, that's treated as the analog. And then for that particular year in which the analog is identified, and take the climate system for the next season, June, July, August, as the forecast for us. So we're making the assumption that the climate situation will evolve in the same way, which is obviously a massive assumption. So a slightly better way of doing it is to identify a subset of analogues. In this example, I only have three, but that's not necessarily what would be the case. And ideally, there'd be many more, and you could use a climate model ensemble to increase the number of scenarios. But again, from that subset, you would have a summer climate situation from each, which enables you to produce probability forecasts. Or if you wanted to produce a forecast mean, it would be the case that you would need to take a composite of those to give the forecast. I hope that makes sense. Analogues isn't really something that's used so much in seasonal forecasting, but it does have use in statistical downscaling, which I've worked in the past, and hopefully will do again, and also climate change attribution. Just a few words about the difference between deterministic and probabilistic prediction. So, in comparison with output from dynamical models, in which there are a number of different ensemble members, and as a result, probabilistic forecasts, most empirical methods are deterministic. So, deterministic forecast is individual, that can be judged right or wrong. It's very difficult to compare this with what we get out of climate model forecasts, which are probabilistic in nature. So for comparison with probabilistic output from dynamical systems, it's necessary that our empirical forecasts have to be probabilistic as well, which I'll talk about in the next section, which is the development of a global empirical prediction system. This is something that I worked on in the first 6 to 12 months in my last job in the Netherlands at KNOI. So this was as part of the SPECT project, which is an EU-funded project concerned with seasonal to decadal and climate prediction for the improvement of European climate services. And in the work package I was involved in, the design brief was to develop this prototype empirical prediction system that can be applied globally and with probabilistic output for temperature and precipitation. trying to, for the first time, exploit the long-term trend as a source of skill, with the idea that this would act as a benchmark for dynamical forecasts, which I mentioned already, as well as a forecast system in its own right. So there was a seasonal model which was led by KNMI and by myself, and then the same authors worked on a conceptually similar prediction model for on decadal timescales. This was led by the University of Reading, but yeah, same authors were going on. So, in comparison to some of the empirical methods that I've mentioned, the statistical model behind this system is actually quite simple. It's based on multiple linear regression. With a number of different predictors, we're taking the CO2 equivalent, which is an annual representation of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, and then modes of variability that I've described, and also locally varying predictors. But while it's a fairly simple statistical model, the selection of the predictors is very much based on physical principles to the fullest extent. So we're relying on our understanding of the climate system. And rather than just throwing as many predictors as possible, we're really trying to avoid model overfitting. I'll just quickly go through how we do this. So we have a separate model fitting for each season and for each grid point, in which we're taking the CO2 equivalent as a predictor in all circumstances, and then a subset of predictors describing internal variability in the climate system, so ENSO, PDO, QBO, IOD, and a few of the local ones. And then in the predictor selection step, we are identifying which of those are potentially useful, so some of them will be cut out, and the rest go into the forecast model. At the model fitting stage, again for each grid point and for each season, we take a random sample of the residuals of the model fit, which are then added to the deterministic estimate in order to produce a forecast ensemble, and this makes our forecast system probabilistic. This is a relatively simple way of producing a probabilistic forecast. There's other ways of doing it. Maybe not a limitation, that's maybe the wrong word of the system, but there's scope for that to be improved. Okay, so this is just demonstrating how the predictor selection is done. Again, this is the plot that I showed earlier, showing correlation between observations and predictions for December, January, February temperature using CO2 equivalent to the long-term trend as a predictor. We then look at what is the incremental skill that we gain by adding additional predictors. So I should point out that each predictor has the trend and the climate change signal removed from it. So the most important, as I mentioned, the most important mode of variability is ENSO, so it makes sense for that one to go first. And these are the regions, the coloured regions I haven't got coloured by here, sorry, just to demonstrate the point. But yeah, the redder the region, the greater the degree of skill that we're gaining. So after taking ENSO, we then look at PDO, with the ENSO signal removed. There's not a lot left, actually, in most cases, other than the region in the North Pacific, where PDO is quite notable. This is the Atlantic multi-decadal oscillation, which is quite important in the Atlantic, as you can see, and also in parts of Africa. And then after we've taken all of those, we then look at whether we can gain any additional information using persistence, so simply taking the climate of the preceding month. And when we've identified the predictors that are useful, we then put those in the multiple linear regression model, and we find a correlation, this is correlation between observations and a forecast that uses all of these predictors. Correlation is obviously So, just some notes on how the forecasts are generated. We produced forecasts, or hindcasts, as it's for the past, from 1961 to present, using data from all previous years. So it's what would have been possible if we'd been producing a forecast in 2003. We could only use observational data up to 2003. Okay, so it's rather than being a sort of cross-validation approach, it's a causal validation approach. We have deterministic and probabilistic verification measures, and these are updated and disseminated along with the forecasts on the KMI Clients Explorer. KMI is the institute that I worked at before, and there's a very useful website which I'm going to talk about just briefly, that has a number of very useful features for people working with climate data, but perhaps if you just want to look at something quickly or get some climate data or do some basic analysis without really having to go nitty-gritty and doing coding and things like that. So this is it's a website pretty much run single-handedly by my former colleague, Geert-Jan van Oldenborg. So amongst the features, there's obviously access to a massive amount of climate data from observations and models on a variety of different timescales. There's the opportunity to do fairly simple analysis like correlation and regression, explore global teleconnections, for instance. Geert-Jan is quite hot on analysing extremes and extreme value theory, so there's lots of tools there to do that sort of thing. There's a tool for verifying seasonal forecasts, which is something that came out of the SPECS project as well. And then very usefully, there is the Climate Change Atlas, which provides plots and time series of climate change and climate change scenarios across the world, broken down by region and by country, I think, as well. So very useful. If you have any questions about that, then I can address them. What I wanted to do quickly was show you just where the forecasts are online. So this is the Climate Explorer page for the empirical forecast. So this is the forecast for the 3 month period that we're in now, July to September. So this is a forecast made in June using observed data from March, April, May. So as soon as the observed data is made available, as soon as that observed data is made available, then you can perform the forecast. So this is for temperature. We also have some verification methods, correlation, for instance. So actually, it only goes up to 0.5 because for temperature it's pretty strong. There is the continuous rank probability skill score, which is a measure for verifying the probability distribution of temperature from the ensemble of forecasts. There's different variables as well if you look at sea level pressure. And again, the forecast among these, or maybe the correlation, because that's quite interesting. So again, for the same period, in this case for sea level pressure, correlation is quite high, sort of across the tropics, and less so during the latitudes, which is probably something that you would anticipate in dynamical forecasts as well. Yeah, I just wanted to show you that's available, fairly simple. I assume that this will continue to be generated every month, even though I'm not there anymore. Back to the presentation. Okay, just a quick summary then. So this empirical prediction system was documented in a paper in Geoscientific Model Development. I intend to do a systematic comparison of my verifiable forecast, which I just showed you, with some operational forecasts from dynamical systems. So this is from ECMWF, for instance. Not necessarily to say that this is better, but just to identify areas where maybe the dynamical systems are can be improved, but they're not operating at the highest skill, which is potentially possible. There's sort of a conceptually similar model for decadal prediction, which I mentioned, which was led by the University of Reading. That was published in Climate Nights earlier this year. But there are further applications for this and similar empirical forecast systems. And I'd just like to talk about a couple of these, and maybe other people have ideas as well. So before I left KNY and came to CORE, I was involved on a successful proposal for this project, PreReal, which is centered on the predictability of wildfire activity in the circumboreal biome, which means the sort of Siberian and Canadian forests. So this is a 4-year project. Obviously, I'm not working on it on a day-to-day basis, but I have done some analysis already and will hopefully complete that over the coming months. So I've been looking at taking forecasts of maximum temperature and precipitation from that same empirical forecast system, and then calculating the monthly drought cone, which is a well-known indicator index for fires. The plots here show correlation between the forecasted and observed monthly drought cone during summer. The correlation is, colours don't reflect so well on the screen, but the correlations are reasonably high, particularly in the early part of summer. And then if we break that down into reasonable means, the forecast of the monthly drought cone are fairly strongly correlated with observations. So that's sort of a verification of how well we're able to forecast the monthly drought cone. The next comparison is made with actual episodes of fire activity. So we have a data set from 2001 to 2011. And in this plot here, the fires are split by severity, so the most severe fires. They're all fairly severe fires, an awful lot of very, very small fires that we're not necessarily interested in for this analysis. But these are split by severity. So each of these bubbles or circles represents a fire episode, and the size of the bubble represents the area burned. And the colour represents the corresponding forecast from my forecast system for monthly drought cone for the corresponding month and year. So, and the ones, it's probably not clear again from where you're sitting, but the circles with a solid line around them are, they represent fire occurrences that are associated with an anomalous MDC forecast, and we find that around 3/4 of severe fires are associated with a forecast which is higher than usual. So there's plenty more to be done. I'm not sure when I'm going to fit it in, but hopefully there'll be more analysis to come on that. So just as a second application, something that I've been thinking about since I knew I'd become to CORE, is the potential to develop an empirical system for forecasting crop yields in Europe and in other parts of the world. And again, thinking about it in the same way, I would ideally like a situation where we have an empirical forecast of crop yields that potentially we can put on a website or something similar to what I've just shown you, that allows it to be used as a benchmark for some of the well-known systems for forecasting crop yields, such as that run by the Joint Research Centre of the European Commission. So I've mentioned it because either some of you guys or other CORE members here may be people that are working directly with potential end users of this information. So it's important just to this isn't something that I've worked on, it's just something that I think is a possibility to look at and work into. Quick summary then. So, yes, as I mentioned, dynamical models using numerical climate models are process-based and can resolve non-linear terms, which gives them an inherent advantage over empirical models. But when the processes involved in seasonal prediction are linear, the dynamical methods may have no clear advantage. So the question is it worth all that additional computational expense if we can do something similar and maybe even more useful in certain parts of the world using empirical methods? So just to finish, empirical methods do have an important role to play as a benchmark for aiding the development dynamical models, as I mentioned, but also as a credible alternative or a supplement to dynamical forecasts. I think I'll leave it there. Thank you for listening.
Is there any question for Jonathan?
Well, that's a good question. It's going to be pretty basic in terms of the climate science. But based on my experience of working in places, perhaps you'd call them temperate, arid parts of the world, like the Great Plains of the US or Southeast Australia, you get like extremely localized weather phenomena, rainfall mainly. So you can have one river which has been in drought for 30 years and one river that just happens through stochastic events to have had a number of rain spells. So at what spatial scale does typically do your models kind of, the predictions break down, and what does that depend on?
Fairly coarse, to be honest. Yeah, so the ones that I'm working on at the moment, even those, the ones for the pre-real project, the wildfires, the resolution, which is governed by the observational data that you're using in the first place is around 1 degree, by 1 degree, so 100 kilometres. So never able to capture anything, even seasonal phenomena that exist on scales that are smaller than that. And so you mentioned arid regions, but also in mountainous regions you could potentially have a massive difference in seasonal climate in a particular, say for the coming summer, for instance, or coming autumn months, you may have something massively different either side of a mountain range, for instance. But it's a limitation of not just the availability of the data, but the most that you could probably do with empirical methods without that don't consider a stochastic element, as you mentioned.
So is that where the clear advantage of the process-based models come in when you're talking about topographic forcing and things like that?
Well, yes, but the models used for seasonal prediction don't operate on the same spatial scales as something like the models used for weather forecasting, for instance. Am I allowed to do one supplementary slide? I wasn't going to do that. This is a figure that I borrowed from this around, borrowed from someone else, probably borrowed from someone else. And I don't necessarily agree with it, but this is his impression of the skill that we have, which is a black line in forecast skill on days. This is weather forecast, which is quite high. And then for seasonal forecast, we have something that's maybe close to the potential skill and the required skill. I'd agree that that's the case in regions of strong interconnections. It's certainly not the case in Europe. But there's sort of these two wells either side where a lot of research is centred at the moment in decadal prediction and also sub-seasonal predictability. And that's kind of the link between the two. And that's probably along the lines of certainly where there's a lot of models now which are designed to seamless predict, so models that are able to produce forecasts of weather on day-to-day. day basis, prior to seasonal forecasts. And yes, the role of empirical methods in this area is not